Narrated by Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu, Allah's Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, whoever makes salah like us and faces our qibla like we do and eats our slaughtered animals is a Muslim and is under the protection of Allah and of Allah's Messenger's protection. So do not betray Allah by betraying those under Allah's protection. Do not betray us. Do not bring people to the masjid to be buried and washed by the Muslims. And you know that they are not praying people. And you know they don't pray. And you know they don't make any salah. And you know they don't make the salah. Don't lie. Muslims, you're going to cover the brother's fault. Don't be ridiculous. Don't be ridiculous. That's not a fault. That's kufru illah. So you bring his body in for us to wash. And you bring his body in for everybody to pray for mercy for him. And he was not even concerned in his life for his own mercy. Don't cheat. Don't lie. An unbeliever is not supposed to be washed by the Muslims. An unbeliever is not supposed to be prayed for by the Muslims. An unbeliever is not supposed to be buried by the Muslims. Haram, haram, haram. Don't do it. Don't betray those who are under Allah's protection. Don't betray the trust. There's no prayers for them. And there's no prayers after they are buried. And if they were in the Muslim world, the clothes that they died in, they would take them to a burial spot and dig a grave for them in the clothes that they died in and then put them in the grave, in the clothes that they died in and cover the grave and walk away. Don't lie to your ummah. Give da'wah to your brother, your friend. How can he be your friend? He's not praying. You know he's not praying. How could you call yourself his friend and walk around with him and die with Allah? You leave him and he doesn't pray. How is that? What sort of friendship is that? One mihdan, al-aslami, radiallahu anhu. أن كان في مجلس مع النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم فأذن بالصلاة فقام النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم ثم رجع محجن في مجلسه ثم رجع ومحجن في مجلسه فقال ما منعك أن تصلي ألست بمسلم قال بلى ولكني صليت في الأهل أو في أهلي قال له إذا جئت فصلي مع الناس وإن كنت قد صليت Mihjan ibn Aslami, al-Aslami narrated, radiallahu anhu, that he had been sitting with the Messenger of Allah, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When the adhan for the salah was called, Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, got up and prayed. And when he returned, he found Mihjan sitting where he had been. So he asked him, what prevented you, when you heard the adhan, what prevented you from praying along with the people? Aren't you a Muslim? He replied, certainly, Messenger of Allah, but I already prayed at home. Allah's Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, said to him, when you come to the masjid and you already prayed and the time for prayer comes, pray along with the people, even if you have already prayed. There are many sayings of the companions of the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that carry this meaning. عمر بن الخطاب رضي الله عنه قال لا حظ في الإسلام لمن ترك الصلاة. There's no portion of Islam for anyone who abandons the salah. وقال رضي الله عنه لا إسلام لمن ترك الصلاة. Anyone who abandons Allah has no Islam. معاذ بن جبل said the same. عبد الرحمن بن عوف said the same. ابن أبو هريرة said the same. عبد الله بن مسعود رضي الله عنه said the same. And many of the companions all say the same. There's someone who said he's Muslim and does not make the salah is not a Muslim. It's not matter what you say. إِنَّكَ لَا تَهْدِي مَنْ أَحْبَبْتْ وَلَكِنَ اللَّهُ يَهْدِي مَنْ يَشَاءُ. You do not guide who you love. But Allah guides who He wills. You do not guide Him based upon skin color. You do not guide them based upon block affiliation, or city affiliation, or gang affiliation, or bloodline, or blood tie, or no bloodline, or no blood tie. And part of our communal problem is that people want to cover the sins of others while they ruin community because that's his boy. Whoever your boy is who doesn't pray and brings destruction to community, you got an enemy for your boy. الرجل ومر على دين خليله وانظروا أحدكم من يخالل. A person is on the deen of his friend. Look one of you who your friend is. Look at your friend. علي بن مسعود رضي الله عنه قال من صره أن يلقى الله تعالى غدا مسلما فيحافظ على هؤلاء الصلوات حيث ينادى بهن فإن الله شرع لنبيكم سنن الهدى وإنهن من سنن الهدى ولو أنكم صليتم في بيوتكم كما يصلي هذا المتخلف في بيته لتركتم سنة نبيكم ولو تركتم سنة نبيكم لدللتم. He who likes to meet Allah tomorrow as a Muslim should persevere in observing these prayers when the call is announced for them. Because Allah has laid down for your Prophet ﷺ the paths of guidance. And these prayers are among the paths of right guidance. If you were to pray in your homes, like this man stays away, who stays away from the masjid and prays in his house, you would abandon the practice of your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And if you were to abandon the practice of your Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, you would go astray. وما من رجل يتطهر فيحسن الطهور ثم يعمد إلى مساجد من هذه المساجد إلا كتب الله له بكل خطوة يخطوها حسنة ويرفوه بها درجة ويحط عنه بها سيئة وذكر رأينا وما يتخلف عنها إلا منافق معلوم النفاق ولقد كان الرجل يؤتى به يهادى بين الرجلين حتى يقام في الصف. So no man purifies himself and does it well and starts off with one of the masajid except that Allah will record a blessing for him for every step he takes, rising him a degree and taking away from him a sin from him because of it. I have seen the time when no one stayed away from it except a hypocrite who was well known for his hypocrisy. A man would be brought in swinging through the weakness between two men until he was set up in a row. The point made here is that if a person didn't answer the adhan, and would be considered live close by and can hear the adhan. Live close by and can hear the muaddin, the muaddin call to the prayer. The companion said they would consider him, he'd be well known that he's a hypocrite, well known for his hypocrisy. The point is here, what about the one who leaves the salah altogether? Ibadullah, fathers, mothers, teach your children at 7. Start to teach them at 7 years old. At 7 years old, they understand. As you heard recently the statement of Ali ibn Abi Talib, radiallahu anhu, my sheikh, hafidahullah, who said that Ali ibn Abi Talib said that from 1 to 7, you play with them. All they want to do is play. So play with them. But you be prepared from 7 to 14 to teach them. To teach them the salah. And at 10 years old, if they leave the salah, then you hit them about it. Not break their skin. Not bruise them, but hit them, because there's khayr in hitting them at 10 if they leave the salah. Because your messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, has commanded you to do so. Do not leave one thing he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, about raising children. You do not know better than him, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So that you want now will be trying to teach them. And from 14 on, then you walk with them. You answer their questions. You become their companion. You talk with them because you taught them. But if you don't teach them, what would you and I expect if we don't teach them when they're young? What do we expect? Because by teaching the young ibadullah, we will raise what we want. It's one thing to talk to an adult and try to run around behind the street behind this guy and that guy. It's another thing to have five of your own children, and you have five, and you have five, and you have five, and there's 100 children, and you got five, there's 150 children, and you got five, and you got five, and you got five, and you all teach them the truth, then you will come with a generation of people who will do what? Follow the truth, and you have a relationship with them. You will be their family. But to do that, you must persevere, sisters. Mothers, you must persevere. Fathers, you must persevere. For a new society, you have